what we're doing here on this voyage is we're listening for whales. We're using the whales' sounds as a primary means of finding these whales. Antarctic blue whales make a couple of different types of calls. They're just barely audible to us. They sound very bassy and almost like a low rumble rather than a sound. You almost, when you have the headphones on, you almost feel them more than you hear them.
Hello, Bridge. We'd like to deploy a sonar buoy, please. It will be number 77.
In order to find these whales, we're deploying sonar buoys. They're military devices that are usually deployed from aircraft to listen for submarines, but we've repurposed them so that we can listen to Antarctic blue whales. Sonar buoys will have directional sensors in them that allow us to work out the bearing to each call. And by recording from multiple sonar buoys at the same time, we can actually triangulate the whale's position precisely enough to locate them visually.
My experience over the years, I've got to know the behavior of the blue whales. They can be very unpredictable, but that's one of the challenges. So the task is to get the ship in close proximity to the whales for photo identifications. If the whales are traveling in a straight line at a constant speed, it's relatively easy to get the ship in the correct position, but if they're doing unpredictable things, it's more of a challenge and you have to use different tactics. It's really predicting where the whales are going to come up and have the ship in the correct position, travelling at the right speed. It's quite a challenge, but it's one I really enjoy.
As of today, during this project, we have photo identified 18 individual blue whales. One of them we identified four times, and that whale we first photographed and identified it at the Bellanies a week ago. And then after the Bellanies, 3 days later, we photographed it in an area of blue whales that was to the east of the Bellanies. And then the very next day, again, and a little further east from the Bellanies, we photographed it. And then we just had it yesterday in this Polynya. So yeah, it's been moving with us, or we've been moving with it. We aim to get photographs of individually identifiable Antarctic blue whales, and what that means is a photograph that's clear and close enough of the animal that you can identify it as an individual, similar to you would a person. Every blue whale is uniquely identifiable because of the mottling pattern on their flanks. So photo ID data are very useful for a number of research questions. One is to estimate abundance. You can also use those data to determine migration patterns. It can also be used for life history parameters such as calving intervals and life expectancy, that kind of thing.
If we can get close enough to the blue whales, then we can take a biopsy sample. And a biopsy sample can tell us many things, including how many individuals are in a population, how many populations there are around Antarctica, and also the diet of the Antarctic blue whales. Other species of Antarctic whales migrate north and come close to countries where we can actually monitor their migration and actually count the number of individuals. The humpback is the classic case. They migrate close to shore and they're reasonably easy to count, and we've now established that those populations are recovering well. We can't do that for Antarctic blue whales. They're not coastal species. They don't come close to areas where they're easier to study. So the only way we can do that is to come down here and work with the blues. You know, it's obviously a logistically difficult operation, and we've now developed the tools to find blue whales really efficiently. We've had many, many sightings during the voyage, and we can actually now, because we can find them so efficiently, we can actually look at what they're doing, look at their behavior, what is their habitat, what krill they're feeding on, what is the nature of the krill, why do blue whales seem to congregate in certain hot spots.